Okay, happy Wednesday, everybody. I have a huge update on what's going on with our weather pattern. It is about to change. We still have our severe weather for today and for tomorrow. Also, a little bit on the day after that. Plus, it's going to add up to some snow for New England still. But our next weather pattern, after we get this long-duration AR, atmospheric river over here from the northwest, anywhere from 4 to 5 days long, it's going to be a lot of flooding and a lot of heavy snow. We have another cold blast coming through. Now, this cold blast is going to punch all the way towards the south central, but it's going to be on a higher ridge towards the east coast in this direction, bringing in chances for snow and freezing rain across Ohio Valley and across the Great Lakes. On another note, I have a special message. At the end of the video, it's not what you think. If you're in a rush, timestamps are down below. Now, if you look here on all of North America, you can see in our vorticity that as we get our severe weather event that's going on for today, also for tomorrow, we'll go towards the northeast. Then we're going to have a little group of storms that's going to break off from the Pacific Northwest, come across the upper Midwest, across the Great Lakes. But look at the pattern that is setting up now. Now you have one low pressure system. You have another one feeding into this one as well, bringing a lot of heavy rainfall, a lot of precipitation. This is going to bring a lot of heavy snowfall as well, all the way from Washington, Oregon, California, going into Idaho, Montana, and Wyoming. It's a long duration, potentially in 6 days, move further down California, maybe bring another problem with all those burn scars with the flooding. But the whole time, did you catch it? Look down here. We almost get a cutoff low down here all the way into the Gulf. Now, it's not cut off. You can see it is getting pulled still by the jet stream right there. It's just a little bit lower on the subtropical jet somewhat. Then it finally comes in later on. Now, this is going to create a problem as we go down below, because as you can see, we do get that upper level high right here that actually locks it right in place. So it stays down there the whole time and just building and building. And finally, it comes back with the next trough that comes in and carries it away. This is going to be part of our freezing rain and next snowstorm. But you need to watch that carefully, because that's going to tell you every part of the next system. So as we go through for the severe weather going on for today, also what's going to transition as we go overnight, this is going to be overnight storms, everyone. Chances for nocturnal tornadoes as well, as this goes all the way for tomorrow for Louisiana, for southern Arkansas, going into Mississippi. Then it will transition towards that northeast. But there's another day of severity as well, everyone. But you can also see we're starting to get that first piece of that system come in from the northwest by Friday. Now, if you take a look in this area, you can see that your dew points raise up all the way from 55 into the 60s as you go through this afternoon. Then once you get towards midnight and overnight, this is where it's going to transition over. But this is where your severe weather is going to be for today, and then it's going to transition for tomorrow, go right across southern Arkansas, across Louisiana, into Mississippi with those 60 dew points. And you can see this with the NAM, just to get a glimpse of what comes later. You can see it does ride the Gulf. It's not super accurate, but can give you a look into what's coming later on. And you see it does carry across southern Mississippi, southern Alabama, into the panhandle of Florida. We even have severe weather risk for that day. So as you take a look for today, you can see that all your Cape, all your instability stays right around those 55 and 60 dew points. So your severe weather is for Texas for today. But then as you go overnight, this is where it's going to transition. This is where you're going to get another group of storms coming from the Gulf, while this group of storms is moving towards the east. And this is all going to collide together to one strong front. Even increase your chances for tornadoes as this goes towards southeastern Texas into Louisiana. I think they're even going to be a little portion of southern Arkansas in there. And you can also see with the NAM as you go into Friday, it's going to increase in convection as it goes across southern Alabama as well. And this will carry into southern Georgia, also for the panhandle of Florida. Your significant tornado perimeters factors in all these things, including wind shear and everything I will show you. But your best chance for tornado will be with those line of storms for today, all evening, and overnight hours. This is where it congeals together overnight into the early morning hours. And look how it all pinpoints towards southern Arkansas. You see that? Both of these all go into this direction, and that forms up a good threshold meeting right around southern Arkansas. So it could be a quick flare-up or even an upgrade for northern Louisiana, southern Arkansas, far northwestern Mississippi. So as you look at a reflectivity of HRRR and see what is projecting could happen through the evening, show showing is just a big flare-up of regular rain and some storms that fire up all in those 50, low 50, all the way to the high 55 dew points. And then once it starts getting into the 60s, that's where you really meets up with that convection, and you start getting the storms coming in from North Texas as you go later in the evening. Now, notice as you go through the night, not only do you get a linear event, bringing some chances for some damage and winds on this line of storms as this moves to the east, you can see a few cells, discrete cells, that do pop up in front of that line of storms, bringing the chances for a quick spin up with one of these cells as you go through the overnight hours. It's going to be over here closest to the lower side where your instability is. Instability is not far over here. That's why you see that broken apart. But you see that cell, while you go early in the morning, while you're getting chances for some damage and winds, you can see the line of storms. Then as it comes in for tomorrow morning, look how it comes through. And you get a line of storms, discrete storms, right in front of that line as well, coming right off the Gulf as you go by tomorrow afternoon from southeastern Texas. And that goes into north-northwestern Louisiana with a strong group of storms. Now that could be an issue because the winds are going from south to north, then the winds above are going from west to east, from southwest to northeast. So it does have that wind direction change with height as you go through the evening for tomorrow. Then as is, maybe get some more damaging winds of a linear storm moving through while you just have regular thunderstorms on the northern side. You can see also, again, it brings discrete cells as you go by tomorrow night in front of this line of storms. Showing after that with the NAM, it could be a milder event, but there's still going to be a threat. So for today, for your threat, it is marginal. You still have that 2% chance for tornadoes. So far, here's your cities in Texas at risk. But you also can see as you go overnight, there's an accompanying risk for an isolated strong to locally severe that will likely continue through the overnight. A southern portion of the band near the I-35 corridor overnight, a marginal risk for severe gusts, and perhaps a tornado could develop with this activity, everybody. And as you go overnight into tomorrow, you still have that tornado risk, and it does grow, everyone. You have the 2% in the green, the 5% in the brown. So far, here's your cities and states at risk for that tornado threat as you go overnight into Thursday. You also have the wind threat in the same locations. And this is where you have the potential for locally damaging winds and a couple of tornadoes where it will increase as this goes late evening into early afternoon across Louisiana as well. But here we go for Friday, and we also have a 5% risk for Friday. So here's your cities and states at risk for the severe weather as this continues across Friday. Showing that strong and gusty winds could approach a severe level, and even a brief tornado or two cannot be ruled out, everybody. But also will be weakening as it goes across northern Florida and southern Georgia. Now after that, that is going to go towards the northeast and bring y'all some snow, still all the way for far northern New England. The higher elevations is going to get that for upstate New York, Vermont, New Hampshire, and Maine. And yes, Vermont, not Idaho. But then you still have that atmospheric river that's going to hit all along the west coast for multiple days, looking like 4 or 5, adding up to a lot of heavy rainfall and a lot of snow in the higher elevations of the Pacific Northwest. Then maybe going down southern California, that right there is not so sure. Then we're going to get that piece of energy coming from the Gulf, coming right on in, bringing our next snowstorm and ice storm. Then we have that cold front coming through, bringing your chance for that snow to come in. Still have the 2 to 3 inches all the way from Texas, still going towards western Tennessee, western Kentucky, a little bit of southern Illinois, southern Indiana. And look how much adds up for the northwest while you get that atmospheric river. It really localizes right for the next 6 days, right towards southern Oregon, northern California, bringing a lot of heavy precipitation and a lot of snow. And it will go across Idaho, western Montana, and western Wyoming. And bringing the snowfall for the far northern Great Lakes all the way to the UP and Michigan, all the way across New England, bringing that 3 to 5 incher. But all that orange for upstate New York, the higher elevations of Vermont and New Hampshire and some of Maine can go anywhere from 6 to 9 inches, maybe a little bit more. It could overperform. And for the northwest, just turn into feet of snow. Showing with the national blend of models, you could get some as far as northern Dakota, far northern Dakota. A lot of this is going all through Canada, everyone. It went up on that higher ridge. Far northern Wisconsin, far northern Minnesota, mostly northeastern Minnesota, the UP and Michigan, and look for New England. This one is going to be a little bit lighter potentially for western New York. You could have that warmer scenario through the daytime on that high ridge. But look at all the snowfall adding up over here for Canada. That's 7 feet of snow. The higher elevations of Washington, Oregon, even getting California in there. All that pink is over 1 foot. All that blue to that purple starts going 2 to 3 feet of snow. Also for Idaho, western Montana, western Wyoming into higher elevations of Colorado. Then we're going to go into that snowy pattern, start getting freezing rain, some ice storms, and a lot of snow. Now the Euro is taking a lot warmer of a scenario as that comes across, bringing a good bit of snow coming across the Great Lakes, also towards the northeast, adding up to a lot more snowfall, and just a little bit over here for the upper Midwest. This is going a lot into Canada. This could be anywhere from 3 to 5. It could be a little bit heavier. Also bringing the freezing rain side to that. So it looks like a warmer scenario, which is not going to be a lot of snow, but it would be a lot of mess and slop, and really a bad scenario, and just a sloppy travel, everyone. But then that cold blast is going to come right behind that and just increase your chance. GFS is seeing the same thing as that comes through, is bringing a little bit more into Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, and the UP. So we still don't know yet how much snow we're going to get in 4 days exactly, everyone. Also showing a good snowfall coming in with that other clipper as well. And is going to bring that warmer scenario, just like the Euro is seeing when that comes in from the Gulf, bring a lot of freezing rain with that. That's going to bring a lot of freezing rain with the GFS and the Euro. But you can see it for both models showing that warmer scenario of bringing a lot of freezing rain, the ice storms, the slop across the Ohio Valley, the Great Lakes, out through the Northeast. This is your GFS. This is with the Euro. They're both seeing this warmer anomaly, which is going to be a nasty and dangerous transition, everybody. So for the next 6 to 10 days, you have this big warm-up, as you know it, even way above average across the four corners, everyone, and way below average on the Pacific Northwest. That's going to be the beginning of an extreme pattern. It's going to be a little bit weaker of the same scenario as you go towards the 10th. But this is where it's going to abruptly change. And this is where we're going to go to the data, because you can see the difference in the data. Remember, the data comes out before the models come out. And you can see your temperature anomaly as we go to the beginning of February. We get this below average anomaly that pushes through, which is pretty weak. It keeps us above average all along the Southwest and along the Gulf of America. I got it right. But after that, we have that cold front coming through. Now, GFS is showing that it will be mostly coming in from the western side of the lower 48 all the way towards the south central, by the time we go towards the 10th frame, and then maybe get blocked and then go right back to the western side, and we go back into that big warm up on the eastern side, have two big extremes. Then after this, I am showing it is going to slowly start retracting back for the end of February, and we will go into our spring, everyone. Now here's the difference. The Euro and the GFS are exactly opposite. Showing with the Euro, after we go past the third, that this cold front comes through, confirming it is somewhat of a weaker cold front. They're both agreeing to that. But then it's also showing that it will dominate and bring colder air on the eastern side of the lower 48. And it'll bring above average on the western side of the lower 48. They're exactly opposite. What's actually going to happen is this is going to punch all the way towards the south and go right back up to its warm up. So you can see this when you look at the data. So remember your weather pattern, everyone. You have your negative phase on your PNA, Pacific North American pattern, where you get that trough coming in from the western side of the U.S. Then you have your positive phase, which does the exact opposite. This is where you get those troughs, getting your best chances to get those snowstorms for the south and the eastern side of the lower 48. So as we take a look at the data, because remember, the data comes out first, the models will catch up with the data later on. So as we look first with the Euro, what I just showed you, the PNA, the Pacific North American pattern, that after we go out of this negative, the cold air leaves, we're going into this above average warm up. It's suggesting that we will go right back into a neutral phase, maybe even that positive phase. So that's why you see in the cold air come back into the eastern side of the lower 48 with the Euro, because it's showing a positive phase. Now, when you look with the GFS, it is the exact opposite. It's showing the negative phase. That's why you see it go back to the western side of the lower 48. But if you look at this, it is suggesting it could go back to that neutral. Both of them are suggesting that could be at least that neutral phase. So that is a suggestion between both of them. But the cold air. So the Euro is showing that the cold air is coming right back in after we go past the 10th and beyond a little bit. A good dip of cold air coming through. GFS is seeing the same thing, but seeing a gradual dip and not so much of a big dip like the Euro. So let's go to the ensemble. That should be able to figure it out, right? No, the ensembles is actually showing the same thing. The GFS is going to that negative. The Euro is going towards that positive. The only other factor we have is the Canadian, which is agreeing somewhere around that neutral, right in that middle phase. And that's the phase that is going to bring it straight down, punch down towards the center of the lower 48, not the west or the east. So you can see this as you look at your temperature anomaly with the Euro EPS, the Ensemble Prediction System. This is made for medium to long range, more confidence on a 5-day average. You can see as we push through, this cold anomaly pushes away, we go into our above average anomaly. We even get our above average coming in from Canada because of that high ridge, remember that. Then after this above average anomaly pushes out, here comes our below average anomaly from the 7th and on. And look how it punches through towards the south central and goes up on that higher ridge. That means it's going to punch through and make a trough like this and bring your storms in this direction, chances for the freezing rain and the snow. Then it's going to retract back some and you're going to go back into a above average pattern as we go towards the end of February. Then you're going to have your colder air locked in over here for the Pacific Northwest while you stay above average for the Southwest all the way towards the Eastern U.S. Then after that, we're going to go back into our above average anomaly as we go into March, everybody, and really start our springtime, I believe. Now, before you go, quick message. I think we are a lot stronger as a community than anything else. Anyone that's been on my channel for a long period of time knows that I always support a lot of weather YouTubers out there. I'm pretty much the only one. Someone has to lead the way. But I always supported them out there. And matter of fact, we have this young man right here, Max. He's a great guy. I've seen him many times. I do support him. And he's trying to get to 1 million subscribers. He is so close. I believe with y'all out there helping, please go to the link in the description. I'll even put it up here on the right corner of the screen if I can figure it out. And you can go to his channel and click and subscribe. Help get him to 1 million subscribers. He is a great guy. He's even learning his craft. He will be a meteorologist. Please help the community. The more people we have out there helping people, the safer everyone will be. Thank you again for your time and hope you have a very great day. Before I go, 1 Peter 4:8-11. And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. As every man hath received a gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified, through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Have a great day, everybody. Remember, help the community. Go down, subscribe to Max. Plus, he will go live when there's an extreme event, and he don't wait for something to be super big. If it's extreme enough where your life could be at risk, he will go live. And I do have faith in him. I've seen him before. He does great work. Please support him. Above all things, all glory goes to God, our Father in heaven, Yahweh. And I always hope he keeps you safe every single day of your life. And forever. Amen. Hallelujah. I hope you felt that.